Okay, we're going to continue our study now over in 1 John. Wonderful book to go through, so let's go in our Bibles over there. 1 John over here in chapter 1. Now, we're just going to finish up here just a second in chapter 1, and then we're going on here, chapter 2, and get some good things here that the Lord has for us. In chapter 1, as we finish up here, we find out this. We find out that, first of all, we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. It is the sin that separates us from the blessings that God has for us. And you know what? The sad thing about it is that it's hard to figure out. You know, if we trust the Lord Jesus Christ as our Savior that died 2,000 years ago to give us eternal life, and then we have so little faith to trust Him and believe Him that our blessings are conditioned upon our faithfulness. Yet we trust Him for salvation and know that we have eternal life. If the Christian could only learn, my blessings do not fall from heaven just because I'm a Christian. I'm promised heaven. I have that. I'm passed from death unto life. But then I must walk in the light as He is in the light to have fellowship one with another and to have those blessings. Now, we'd like for you to take just a second and go with us back here now, if you will, here to Psalms chapter 139, 23. Psalms chapter 139 here in verse 23. All right, Psalms 139, 23. We got the right one here. 139, 23. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. Boy, oh boy, sometimes we don't want to do that, you know, because He will do that. But you know, that's being honest with the Lord, and that's what He wants us to do. He wants us to be honest with Him. And we come on over now, we're going right on down, because we've covered a pretty good part here of 1 John here, chapter 1. So we don't want to just dwell on those, but go on and get through the whole book here. We come over here now to chapter 2. Hold your place, go with me to Isaiah 43:25. Just hold your place there. Go with me to Isaiah chapter 43 here in verse 25, all right? It says here in verse 25 of Isaiah, as he's speaking. Now, when we're saying, you know, we go back to the Old Testament and here, we find out that these things are written for our learning and our admonition. That's why he gave all of the history of Israel. That's why he put in about Ruth. That's why he put in about Joseph and Jacob and the 12 sons and everything, is to give us the history and to show us the blessings that God had for them when they obeyed the Lord. But all the blessings are taken away when we rebel against the Lord. When you go to Leviticus chapter 26 and the book of Deuteronomy chapter 28, you begin, especially in Deuteronomy 28, you find out the first 13 verses have to do with God said, I will bless thee, I will bless thee. I'll bless the fruit of your womb. I will bless your going in, your coming out. You shall lend and not borrow. And all of these blessings, I'll bless your crops, the fruit of your ground. But then in verse 15 of Deuteronomy 28, he says, if thou shalt not obey the words of the Lord, these are the curses. And he said, when it come morning, you'll say it's evening. When it's evening, you'll want to say it's morning. And he says, you'll be cursed. He said, instead of lending, you'll be borrowing. We know that Israel is out of the will of God. They borrowed here a few years ago, $9 billion from the United States of America. So they are, first of all, borrowing and not lending, showing they are out of the will of God. God said, if you'll serve me, you will be the lender and not the borrower, and so forth. So we come over here to Isaiah chapter 43, verse 25, and it says, I even am he that blotteth out thy transgressions for my own sake and will not remember thy sins. Even after we're a Christian, we have to have our daily walk cleansed because we're walking in an imperfect world. We pick up things and maybe do things, get influenced by things that draw us away from the Lord. Dr. Warren Wiersbe said, anything that dims my view to serve Christ, I've got to cut out of my life. I've got to get away from it. Anything that keeps me from serving the Lord, then I've got to take some appropriate steps. And it is what we've said for years. You will become who you associate with. Important, therefore, to choose your friends wisely. Chapter 2, now he begins to address some things here. He says, my little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. Now, if the Christian, and this sort of refutes all of these holiness groups and your Salvation Army, your Nazarenes, your Pentecostals, and so forth, that say that they can reach this state of sinless perfection. They cannot. He says, my little children, that identifies them, of course, they are Christians. Speaking of Christians here in chapter 1 and 2 and so forth, about having fellowship with the Lord, not sonship now, not talking about our unity with Christ, but our communion with Christ. And he says, my little children, these things write I unto you, that you sin not. So if you ever reach the state of perfection and you couldn't sin, then why would he ask the Christian to sin not? You see, no, each one of us have the proprieties within us in the old nature here in order to be enticed to sin. Anybody ever entice you to do something that afterwards you wish you hadn't have done? Well, I think we all have, haven't we? Surely. So we got to be on guard and that doesn't happen. Then he says, but if any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Now, the word advocate there means one who pleads our case. It's the same word as comforter in John chapter 14 and verse 6. Same word, same Greek word. So we come up down to verse 2, and he is the propitiation. The word propitiation here, as well as chapter 4 and verse 10, lets us know this is the payment for our sins. And not only ours only, but also for the sins of the whole world. And we do know that we know him. Now we're coming into the use of the word know, which is gnosko. And it means know in an absolute perfect confidence that I understand really what God is talking about. Not salvation now, because it doesn't take much to know that Jesus Christ died for us. That's not what John's talking about with this know here, gnosko. It is true in John 17:3 that we may know him and have eternal life. Yes, absolutely for sure. We know God, and we know that he loved the world, know that he gave his son, absolutely. But gnosko is also used as an absolute knowing. It's used in a variety of senses as we go through here and in other places in the Bible. But used here of John, it means absolutely, I understand what God is doing. I understand why that he wants me to serve him. I have no doubts whatsoever the purpose of God in my life, and I understand that. So it's a deeper understanding than just salvation. Now, we're going to take here in verses 4 to 6 here and expound upon them a little bit. He that saith, I know him and keepeth not his commandments is a liar, and the truth is not in him. But whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Means come to a conclusion. It's mature. And that love of God is if we keep his commandments. Because we know there, now we're not talking about the Ten Commandments. If you want to read them, you can go to Ephesians chapter 4, for example, and so forth. And Ephesians chapter 5. And we find out, if you lie, don't lie anymore. And if you stole, don't steal anymore. Be kind-hearted one to another, tender-hearted, compassionate one to another, and so forth. All of these are given down in there. Be angry and sin not. Let not the wrath or the sun go down upon your wrath. We are to be angry at some things. I mean, aren't you angry if somebody lies about you and tries to discredit your character? Well, sure. But what John's talking about, you're not to hate that person. I'm not to hate that person and have anything in my mind to specifically want to see something bad come to them because they have done something bad to me. Nothing wrong with being mad and angry when somebody does that, but that anger is stopped right there and it has not progressed to the point of wanting to see harm done to someone or trying to get back at someone because the Lord said, vengeance is mine, saith the Lord, and I will repay. So we have to turn those things over to the Lord, but not saying that we shouldn't be angry with it, we surely should. But don't let the sun go down upon your wrath. Other words, get it cleansed out. Nothing wrong with getting mad. Did you ever get mad over something? Somebody you've done or something? Absolutely, we all have. But we don't hate them. We don't let it fester in our minds for 3 days, 4 days, a week, a month, a year, and pretty soon begin to eat us up like a cancer. That's not what God wants. That's what John is talking about here. It says in verse 3, "And hereby we do know that we know him if we keep his commandments." Not salvation, but a deeper and more personal knowing of the Lord. As we said, it's not talking about here union with the Lord or salvation, but it's talking about communion with the Lord. Now let's go here in verses 4 to 6. "He that saith, I know him, and keepeth not his commandments." Not talking about salvation now. But I really understand the Lord. I really think like the Lord thinks. I really understand what he's doing. And I really understand the benefits of serving the Lord. I really have a deeper understanding of God, the Lord Jesus Christ, his compassion. I need to walk like he walks and so forth like that. A deeper understanding. Let me ask you this. When a person turns away from the Lord Jesus Christ and is not serving the Lord, do they really understand and believe that God will chasten them eventually if they do not come back and confess their sins to the Lord and then begin to walk in the light as he is in the light? They don't really believe it will happen to them. And that unbelief, not for salvation now, but believing Christ, how he deals with their children, many times has brought the chastisement of God upon his children because of that lack of faith in the Word of God that tells us here that God will chasten his children. Whom the Lord loveth, he correcteth, every son whom he receiveth, and so forth. Now, let's go on down. In verse 5, "Whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. He that saith he abideth in him ought himself also to walk, even as he walked." So we begin to find out, first of all, if I'm going to keep his word, then what do I have to do it? Well, to do his word, you got to know his word. Hold your place there. Go back with me here to Joshua chapter 1, because we're going to pounce back and forth here just a little bit and take some Old Testament illustrations also. Back here to the book of Joshua, we come back here and begin to find, well, the Lord tells Joshua, and he gives Joshua the instructions here. Joshua then goes to the people with it. But if you recall, you'll find out that after the death here of Moses, Joshua then is commissioned to take the people into the promised land. And in Joshua, we have the crossing of the river, the conquering of the enemy, and the claiming the inheritance. So the book of Joshua has a leader by the name of Joshua who is going to lead the people and tell them how to get into the promised land. Now remember this, coming out of Egypt is a type of salvation, but going into the promised land of Canaan is a type of the battles that you and I have to fight in our Christian life. Taking Canaan was an unconditional covenant that God gave to Israel, but it could only be possessed if they walked and went in and got it. Unless we walk with the Lord and walk in the light as he is in the light, we're going to rob ourselves of the happiness, the blessings, the things, the confidence that we have in God. And this is what John's talking about. To really know, even when I'm going through trials, am I going to be faithful or am I going to use it as an excuse not to come to church, use it to quit, use it to drop out because God's failed me? No, God hasn't failed you. God's trying you. He's testing you. Am I going to be faithful in trials? We can all be faithful when everything's going good. We got plenty of money in the bank, cars running good and everything else. And and everything's going great in our house, our home, and our kids. No, the kids aren't sick. We've got no big bills. That's the easiest time in the world to serve the Lord. But what if you have some trials to go through? God will always put the Christian through trials to see if they're going to be faithful under adversity. Always. So you're going to have trials. I'm going to have trials. We're going to continue to have trials until we meet the Lord in the air. Now let's go here to the book of Joshua here. And here the Lord instructs him because he's going to give him something. And we find out the same thing applies to the Christian today. You find out here, as we go here in verse 3, "Every place that the sole of thy foot shall tread upon, that I have given unto you, as I said unto Moses." In verse 4, "For the wilderness of this Lebanon, even unto the great river, the river Euphrates, all of the land of the Hittites, and unto the great sea," that's the Mediterranean, "toward the going down of the sun, shall your shall be your coast. That was about 300,000 square miles. They only claimed about 30,000, or about one-tenth, nine-tenths. They robbed themselves of the blessings. They only got one-tenth of the blessings when they could have had nine-tenths more. God doesn't want you to be one-tenth complete. He wants you to be nine-tenths so he can pour his blessings out upon you. But in order to go in here, now God promises, just like he promises you. He said, I've come that you might have life and have it abundantly. He didn't say that it would be abundantly without trials, but even through trials it can be an abundant life, because it is Christ that causes me always to have the victory in Jesus Christ. There is no trial, in 1 Corinthians 10:13, there's no testing taken such as is common unto man. In every one of the trials that I've ever went through or I'm going to go through, I know this and I go to that verse. Because old Satan says, God would never treat anybody he loved like he's treating you. I thank God that he thinks enough of me to put me through some trials. Sometimes I think that he goes a little bit too far. And I've let him know that. Doesn't seem to alter the course. I've said, Lord, enough's enough. And in fact, now I've made it through the last one, I'll make a little deal with you. I don't care what trial you send, I'm going to pass it. So why send it? Well, it just doesn't seem, I don't know if the Lord's not listening or what it is, but the Lord does know best. But anyway, he wants us to have all of the blessings he has for us, and it thrills God's heart to bless you. It thrills his heart to see that you earn the blessings that he gives you, because you have to earn them. He doesn't just pass them out. Oh, yes, he gives us some we don't earn. But on the majority of the time, all the Lord gives us what we deserve. Amen. Gives us much more, really. But notice what he says there. He says, there shall not any man, be able to stand before thee all of the days of thy life. And as I was with Moses, so will I be with thee. I remember reading some of the great missionary stories. David Brainerd went to the American Indians, died at a very young age. The trials that he went through. The man, can't think of his name now, just slipped my mind here for just a second. That started the great orphanages over in England over there. What was his name? George Mueller. You know, he never asked anybody for a penny. Only thing he did, and he started down, he'd just pray, Lord. Now, and many times the next day he didn't have a thing. Here'd come a milk truck. Here would come a bread truck. Here would come a meat truck. And God laid upon others to supply their needs and so forth there, because he was occupied with this great orphanage over there for kids and so forth, and lead them to the Lord Jesus Christ. And you begin to look at some of these great men and some of these great missionaries, the David Livingston, some of these men that went to Africa and China and places like that, and the mission board didn't want to send them, but they went anyway. And the great work that they did there, the people that they led to the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, I know this, when God leads you to do something, and he's led us all to witness, there cannot any man stand before you. You know, it's an amazing thing. Now, I was going, there's one man in town here in Walnut Grove, and he has did everything he could. He goes to the Catholic Church down here. He's one of the most wicked, lying men I think I've ever met in my life. So I was in the post office Saturday, and he started to come in the door, and I was the only one in there, and boy, he turned, took off, went down the street. You know, it's an amazing thing when you have Jesus Christ, and he walked down there, and he stood in front of the big building. What is that, Greg Lund, or down there, building? And he stood there, and then when I crossed the street to get in my car, then he turned and walked back toward the post office. Boy, his conscience is so eating him up, he doesn't know what to do. Now, not everybody in Walnut Grove's like that, very nice people. But he's one of the worst I've ever seen, but he's a good old boy, he's a good old Catholic. But he's one of the last lying men I've ever seen in my life. And in fact, one day, and I got fed up getting all these feedbacks, and I happened to pass him. I said, you got any new lies you're telling today, Pard? I was in fellowship. You know, but you know one thing? When you read here, first of all, and you're serving the Lord, you don't have to hang your head. You don't have to avoid somebody because you're not lying about them. You want to win them to Christ. But you take the religious people that hate Christianity, you know what? They'll either run from you, they'll have to talk behind your back because they don't have the backbone to face you at all, but not for the Christian. What did he say here? He said, "There shall not any man be able to stand before thee all the days of thy life." You want to establish the character to where you can stand up, and if somebody doesn't want to talk to you or that, it's them that run, not you. That's the kind of person you want to be, and that's the kind of person that God wants you to be. "I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee." The more that we walk with the Lord, the more that we trust Him, the more that we rely upon Him, He will always work out things for good to them that love the Lord. He will always do that. Not maybe everything we think it should be worked out, but He will work them out. And what seems like a tragedy yesterday may turn out to be a blessing tomorrow when the Lord's involved. And that can be. The Lord can put things back together that are broken. Dr. M. R. DeHaan wrote a great book, Broken Things, Broken Pieces, and used many illustrations. The alabaster box had to be broken before the perfume could be allowed to be released there. The wood had to be broken before the boat could be filled. Or built, I should say. We find out the ground had to be broken before the gold can be extracted. And you begin to find there are a lot of things, and sometimes your life has to be broken before God can extract from you the full confidence, the full faith, the full reliability that He wants you to put into Him. Sometimes a person just refuses to do that, and God has to break the Christian through trials in order to get them to put their trust in Him. To extract the precious trust that God wants you to have in Him going through your trials. Sometimes we have things too easy, we keep going too long, and it seems like it's so easy. But maybe we're not really trusting the Lord for things. Maybe we're getting a little bit slack. But notice what He says, "I will not fail thee, nor forsake thee. Be strong and of a good courage, for unto this people shalt thou divide for an inheritance the land which I swear unto their fathers to give them." God swears to you that He'll bring you through every trial you're going through. Only you got to be thou very courageous, that thou mayest observe to do according to all of the law which Moses thy servant commanded thee. Turn not from it to be to thy right hand or to thy left. Well, what do you mean to thy right hand or to thy left? Because there's always somebody out there going to entice you over this way that, you know, you're getting really too religious. You don't really have to go to church Sunday morning, Sunday night. Well, that's true, you don't. But if you want to have a testimony, you want your life to be used for God, you want to be strong, you want to learn the Word of God, you want to study the Word of God, you want to be where God wants you to be, yes, then God wants you to be in church when the doors are open. That's what He wants you to do. And you know what? It always seems like when people are not in church where they should be, it's the time we have visitors. Never fails. Never fails. Remember, you had a lady drove clear down from, I think, Montevideo. And that Sunday, we had hardly anybody in church, and everybody had an excuse. Everybody had an excuse, but there wasn't anybody in church, never been back. We start getting people to come and fill this church up. Success always breeds success. That's why it's so important that next week that you take some of these tracts and you take some of these flyers and you look for an opportunity and pray tonight before you go to sleep. Lord, give me an opportunity next week to invite somebody to church. Maybe many people to church. Now, we've got some things coming up. We've got some movies coming up on the apocalypse and some things like that that we're really going to advertise and really work hard to get a lot of people out and fill this church here and see some of these Doctrine of Last Things here. There's some tremendous films here, just new ones that have come out. And so we're going to have an opportunity, but we need to look for opportunities next week. Now, notice what he says in verse 8. If we never read the Bible in our busy schedule, And this is one of the biggest mistakes that Christians make. I'm too busy. I don't have time. Now, I know. Now, this is just me. This isn't anybody else, because all of our time schedules are different. For me to study in the daytime with the phone ringing and everything else is almost an absolute impossibility. We have to put, when we make a TV broadcast or that, we have to put signs up on the doors because somebody will come, please don't knock, don't do this, we're recording. Or we make the radio broadcast down our radio room there, we have to put up signs, please don't knock or that, so we can do that. But to try to study, I can tell you right now, the phone will ring 100 times a day. I'm exaggerating a little, but there's no way you can do that. My study time, this is just me, and we're not compatible in this particular area, which not many people are. But my schedule begins at many times 4:30 to 5 in the morning, and that's the time I'm up. I get the coffee on, feed cats, love them a little bit, scratch baby's back, and that's her routine, you know, our baby cat, which just happens to be 28 pounds, I think, or something like that, has to have her back scratched after she eats or she gets out of sorts. And the other, who's Jezebel, that's why we named her that, because of her disposition, she's a living terror, must be picked up and put over my shoulder and get a big hug and her back scratched while she's held. Get her calmed down. And then, of course, it's drinking a glass of 2 tablespoons of honey and 1 of vinegar mixed with hot water. And then, by that time, it's about 4:45. About 4:45 to 5:30, I then begin my Bible study until, and I'm not bothered, nobody's up, and the phone doesn't ring, so I can study until 8 o'clock or 8:15, then I go to the post office, get the mail, and come home and eat breakfast. That's my routine, probably 6 days a week. That's my routine. But I know if I don't set a time when I can study without anybody being around, without anybody bothering me or any way else, not that a person's a bother, but you've got to concentrate when you want to study. You've got to be able to concentrate. You can't be interrupted every 5 minutes. Well, what about this? What about that? Somebody's on the phone. They want to talk to you. You might as well hang it up. I can't. Because if I can get 2 hours by myself, I can learn more, retain more, memorize more than I can 6 hours with the phone ringing every 10 minutes. But you have to determine in your life when you're going to study the Bible, when you're going to get alone by yourself, when you're going to shut the house down, take the phone off the hook, and say the next half hour after supper, we're going to read the Bible and take the phone off of the hook and heck with the phone calls. You've got to be able to do that, or I'll guarantee you Satan will make it absolutely impossible for you to study the Word of God, which he hates with a passion. Notice what he says in verse 8. He says, "This book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate." The word meditate here is digesting what we have feasted upon in verse 7. "Therein, day and night, that thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success." So there is a requirement to have good success. Now, you say day and night. Well, let me just say this to you. When I go somewhere, I don't care where, if I'm going to be going an hour drive in the car, I always have my tape recorder with me. I'm either listening to a tape. I always carry my notebook with me, always, because if I think of something, I pull her off of the road then and write it down, because at 64 years old, you'll forget it 5 minutes later and never remember it again for a month. And that is the most aggravating thing that you can get. Maybe it's the mind going. I don't know what it is, but I've learned one thing. I got mind enough to know to stop and write it down. Amen? So I can work on it from there on. Or I may have a thought about something I'm writing or so forth like that, and I want to do it. We were writing a proposal for the book on biblical examination of hell. That's a very lengthy thing that you have to write. Why do you think people would be interested in your book? What are your illustrations that you use? Why did you use these illustrations? Why do you want us to publish your book? What is your background? And you have to put where you went to school and all of your experience. You have to write an extensive resume. All of these things have to be put in there. Why is your book different from any other book? When's the last book that's been put out on the subject that you're there? Have you researched the other publishers? And all this kind of stuff. It is a very lengthy thing. I've been working on that for a week and a half. Got it just about complete. But it takes time. You have to concentrate. I was driving down the road the other day and happened to think of something I wanted to put on the back. It was a very simple thing on there. But in the back, we'd put a comparison with the Douay translation of the Roman Catholic Bible, which they always use the word hell, translated from Hades and Gehenna in the Lake of Fire. The New American Bible of the Roman Catholic Bible has taken all of that away and put netherworld. They don't use hell at all, following exactly what the Jehovah's Witnesses do. So we're going to put a chart back there for that. But then I was driving down the road, I thought, well, why don't you put what all the religions believe about hell? Zoop, I put that over the road. He said, you can't forget that. Oh, yes, I can. Oh, yes, I can. I'm telling you right now, I can. Some of the simple things you think you're not going to forget 5 minutes later, it just like it went whoosh in out of your mind, you don't forget. Any of you ever have that problem? Anybody under 64 have that problem? Well, that's good. That's great. So I thought, well, I'll put what all the other religions believe, like your Mormons, your Jehovah's Witnesses, and so forth, and I'm going to make quotes from their books. So, oop, I wrote it over there. But be sure to add what the cults believe about hell on the very end there, so I'm going to put them in there for it, with a quote. Very simple thing, but boy, it's aggravating when you have a simple thing, can't remember what the simple thing was. Woo, that's bad. Notice what it says. The book of the law shall not depart out of thy mouth, but thou shalt meditate therein day and night, and thou mayest observe to do according to all that is written therein, for then thou shalt make thy way prosperous, and then shalt thou have good success. By doing what? Observing and doing what the Lord wants you to do. You'll either do it, or you'll have a vocabulary of excuses. One of the two. We come on down. Have not I commanded thee, be strong, be of a good courage, be not afraid, neither be thou dismayed, for the Lord thy God is with thee whithersoever thou goest. Matthew chapter 28, verses 18 to 20 says exactly the same thing. Going into all the world, teaching, that is, making disciples in the Greek, teaching them, making disciples of them, baptizing them, and then teaching, that's a different Greek word, teaching them all things, even I am with you even to the end of the world. No matter where I go or what I do, dear Lord, you're there. I can't get out of your presence. You're there. You're with me everywhere I go. Now, go with me back over here. Now, we're going to get back here to 1 John. You just hang on here. Go with me to the book of Nehemiah. All right? Book of Nehemiah. Because these Old Testament men have the same thing. Have the same thing back here. And same things that you and I have. All right? And same principles. They either have to have a desire to do something, just like you have to have a desire to do something today. Those in the Old Testament did not have a desire to do anything. They never did anything. But I want you to notice, because this applies to you, and it applies to me. Here was Nehemiah. He was in captivity. He was the king's cupbearer. Nothing wrong with that. But I'd like for you to notice something here. In verse 2 he says, and Hanani, one of my brethren, came, he and certain men of Judah, and I asked them concerning the Jews that had escaped, which were left of the captivity, and concerning Jerusalem, those that had returned to the land. And they said unto me, the remnant that are left of the captivity there in the province are in great affliction and reproach. The wall of Jerusalem also is broken down, and the gates thereof are burned with fire. Now, we're going to be coming back to Nehemiah a lot, but what was the first thing Nehemiah did? The very first thing he did was he asked. He asked. Let me ask you something. Can we ask, Lord, give me somebody to witness to on Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday? Lord, give me somebody that I can witness to, and I pray that they'll come to church. I pray that they'll trust the Lord Jesus as their Savior. But where does it start? Faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Nobody gets saved unless they hear the Word of God. How precious are the feet of those that preach the gospel or announce the gospel. I'm not just talking about preachers. That's talking about every Christian that announces the gospel. How beautiful are the feet of those that bring the gospel, the tidings of great joy that Christ has forgiven their sins. Faith cometh by hearing, hearing by the word of God. Go you into all the world and preach the gospel, and I'm with you even till the end of the world. Christ told Joshua, I'm with you, I'll never leave you nor forsake you. So I never have to worry about Christ bailing out on me. The thing he has to worry about is me bailing out on him. Amen? He didn't have to worry about me or worry about him leaving. Now notice what he said. Yes, the walls of Jerusalem were broken down. It came to pass when I heard these words that I sat down and wept and mourned certain days and fasted and prayed before the God of heaven. Let me ask you something. Has it ever burdened your heart when you see people running around town in this town here and you know they're lost on their way to hell? Do you ever get a burden for them that you look at them as when they die, you look at them being plunged into eternal damnation, separated from God for all time and eternity? Total darkness when the Lord says, depart from me, you're cursed into the everlasting fire. Or are you too busy? Not enough time. We hardly have time for supper. And when supper's over with, we've got to go here, we've got to go there, we've got to do this, we've got to do that. No time to read the Word of God. No time to meditate on the Word of God. No time to digest what we read. Just a casual reading. Oh yes, I read two verses today there. That's not what brings us success. God wants you to meditate on His Word. He wants you to set a time and move apart your schedule so He is inserted in here, so He can have a part of your life. He can influence your life. He can guide your life, and He can bless your life by you obeying what the Lord wants you to do. But if you don't have any light, you can't walk in the light and have fellowship one with another, because you're going to be walking down the wrong path. I got up this morning and I made a mistake, didn't turn the light on. What was the first thing I do? I walked into that big dumb mirror on the way to the bathroom. Thud. Well, what do you thud a mirror with? The big dumb stand on the floor there, I thudded it with my toe, and I didn't put my shoes on when the minute I got out of bed. Now, that can get you out of fellowship real fast. But Marge was there. She's always there to blame. Or I wonder why she didn't turn the light on. Well, I know why she didn't turn the light on. She's not up at 7. No, whatever. But anyway, that's good. We better go on. All right. It said, I heard these words and I wept and so forth. And then I said, I beseech thee, O Lord God of heaven, the great and terrible God, that he keepeth covenant and mercy for them that love him and observe his commandments. Now we go on. It's sort of interesting here for just a couple of minutes here, because the very next thing he did before he could serve the Lord, and before God gave him the task to do, he observed there was a need. But before he could go anywhere in his life, this is exactly what 1 John talks about. If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves. But if we confess our sin, he's faithful and just to forgive us our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. It's exactly what Nehemiah did. Because if you're not honest with yourself, you'll go nowhere in your Christian life. You are at a stop sign, and you will stay at that intersection for however many days, months, years you want to stay there, until you're honest with the Lord and get the go-ahead. Because God's not going to use you if you're not honest with yourself and honest with Him. Notice what He said. He said, let thine ear now be attentive and thy eyes open, that thou mayest hear the prayer of thy servant, which I pray before thee now day and night for the children of Israel, thy servants, and confess the sins of the children of Israel, which we, that's the plural pronoun, we have sinned against thee, both I and my father's house have sinned. Then he goes on down. He says in verse 11, O Lord, I beseech thee, let now thine ear be attentive to the prayer of thy servant, and to the prayer of thy servants who desire to fear thy name and prosper. Do you have a desire to prosper? Do you have a desire to prosper? Don't you want to be happy? You've got to have a desire to, and you're not going to do it on your own. You're not going to take shortcuts from the Lord and prosper. You're not going to take shortcuts through the woods, get lost somewhere, going down a wrong road, a wrong path, and prosper. You're just not going to do it. It's an absolute impossibility. But he said, the fear of thy name and prosper. I got a desire to prosper. I pray thee, thy servant, this day, and grant him mercy in the sight of this man, for I was the king's cupbearer. Now we go back here to 1 John, all right? Now our time's winding down here, but we want to interweave these things in because it's so important. The Lord said, I've written these things in the Old Testament here for our learning and our admonition here. So we got to be honest and we got to be willing if we want to have the blessings and the happiness that God has for us in our life. Let me read you something. They're always sending me email. Considerate of others, yeah. There's a frail old man. He went to live with his son, his daughter-in-law, and their four-year-old grandson. The old man's hands trembled, his eyesight was blurred, and his step was faltered. The family ate together at the table, but the elderly old grandfather's shaky hands and his failing sight made eating very difficult. There were some peas that rolled off his spoon onto the floor, and when he grasped the glass, the milk spilled on the tablecloth. The son and the daughter-in-law became very irritated with the mess of having grandfather there with them. We must do something about grandfather, the son said. I've had enough of the spilled milk, the noisy eating, and the food on the floor. So the husband and wife set a table in the corner. Their grandfather ate alone while the rest of the family enjoyed the dinner. Since grandfather had broken a dish or two, his food was served in a wooden bowl. When the family glanced in grandfather's direction, sometimes he had a tear in his eye as he sat there alone. Still, the only words the couple had for him were sharp admonitions when he dropped a fork or he spilled some food. The four-year-old, he just watched, didn't say anything, just watched in silence. One evening before supper, the father noticed his son playing with wood scraps on the floor. And he asked the child very sweetly and very nicely, he said, what are you making? Well, just as sweetly, the boy responded. He said, oh, I'm making a little bowl for you and Mama to eat your food when I grow up. 4-year-old smiled and went back to work. The words so struck the parents that they were absolutely speechless, and then tears started to stream down their cheeks, and though no word was spoken, both knew what must be done. So that evening, the husband took grandfather's hand and gently led him back to the family table. For the remainder of his days, he ate every meal with the family from there on. And for some reason, neither husband nor wife seemed to care any longer when a fork was dropped, the milk was spilled, or the tablecloth had a few drops of milk on it. Shows us something. Children are remarkable in their perceptive. Their eyes ever observe, their tears ever listen, their minds ever process the messages that they absorb. If they see us patiently provide a happy home atmosphere for family members, they'll imitate that attitude for the rest of their lives, or should. The wise parent realizes that every day the building blocks are being laid for the child's future. We ought to be wise builders, and that's what God wants us to do. Your home, unless the Lord builds the home, it's built in vain. What John's saying here, whosoever keepeth his word, in him verily is the love of God perfected. Hereby know we that we are in him. I know that when I trust him for everything in my daily life, I trust him to treat people the way that he wants me to treat people. I trust him at times to stand when he expects me to stand. I know that I'm going to be blessed if I rebuke them sharply, that they may be sound in the faith. I know that I'm going to be blessed if I have patience with those that need patience and are going through trials. I know I'm going to be blessed if I can help anybody that I can possibly help whenever I can help them. I'm going to be blessed. Why? Because all that hinges upon the law is fulfilled in one word. Love thy neighbor as thyself. And if I love him, I'm going to help him and I'm going to witness to him. And that's what God wants us to do. Well, I see our time's gone, so let's just bow in a word of prayer, and with our heads bowed and our eyes closed, you know, the Lord might be dealing in your... Have you set a time, or are you too busy to study the Bible? You'll never grow as a Christian if you don't start studying your Bible. You've got to spread your schedule apart and insert a time. Dear Lord, the phone goes off of the hook. I want to sit down for a half hour and I want to read my Bible. And I want to digest what I read. And Lord, apply it to my heart so that it will make me a better person, a stronger Christian, a more confident Christian, and a gnosko Christian, that I know what you want me to do and I'm going to do it. Oh yes, I've trusted you for salvation, but I know that there are other things you want me to do. A deeper knowledge of the Word of God, a deeper walk with the Lord, a more concentrated effort to be the Christian that God wants me to be. And I'll guarantee you, God will overpay you every time. Let's pray. Father, we are so grateful to you, and we thank you. Thank you for loving us, and thank you for this tremendous book here in 1 John. We begin to see, yes, why he emphasized all of that in the Gospel of John for salvation. Now he takes these five chapters here and gives us how to plow the weeds out of our life, how to not rebuke us, dear Lord, but gently try to lead us here to sort of get our thinking sort of stirred up here into realizing that there's more in the Christian life than just coming to church. Our responsibility to witness to other people and not be ashamed of the gospel of Christ. I'll be with you even to the end of the world. I'll never leave thee. I'll never forsake thee. And there is a whole land of Canaan over there, because there's a whole world inhabited by lost people. And we